الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي خلق السماوات والأرض وجعل الظلمات والنور الحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا ومن يهد الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فأولئك هم الخاسرون ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد له الحكم وله الأمر يحيي ويميت هو الأول بدون بداية والآخر بدون نهاية حي دائما لا يموت وهو على كل شيء قدير ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله الله مبشرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما To begin, I would like to first, after saying Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Is everybody tired from the fasting? What day is it? Day four? It's been like one day for me, alhamdulillah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I would like to begin first by showing gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the opportunity to be here in this gathering today. And we say alhamdulillah for that. And we say alhamdulillah for the blessing of al-Islam. And we say alhamdulillah that he allowed us to enter into the gates of Ramadan. For indeed, there are people walking to and fro in the universities, in the marketplaces, our friends and our classmates and our colleagues, and they know nothing. They know nothing about the blessed month of Ramadan that we are in today. And so for that, we say alhamdulillah for the opportunity to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this month wherein the Qur'an, the final testament, the final revelation to mankind, it was revealed. It is a blessing, brothers and sisters, to be able to say ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluh. And then I want to extend my gratitude as well to the facilitators here at Masjid Al-Wali. May Allah bless this community and also bless those who allowed me to be here today and invited me here today to share of the little bit of knowledge that I have. As Allah Ta'ala, he says, عَلَّمَ الْإِنسَانَ مَا لَمْ يَعْلَمْ. He is the one who has taught mankind that which he did not know. And after that, I ask Allah again to bless this talk and to put barakah in the words that I speak, to put benefit in this gathering. And I want to let it be known before I begin my talk, and I'll be talking about connecting the hearts of the youth to the Quran, connecting the hearts of young people to the Quran. But I want to let it to be known first that this speech that I'm giving now, it is not the goal. It is not the destination. Right? Speaking, it is not the goal. speaking becomes the goal, then we have really lost sight of our responsibility as Muslims. What we talk about here today, it should only be a springboard, something that moves us to action. And as a da'i, as someone who goes to this masjid and this event and has the opportunity to speak to communities, too often I see that Muslims come together and we talk about the issue, or we talk about the topic or the problem or what have you, and we leave that lecture and we leave that class or we leave that event feeling as though we've actually done something to solve the problem, as though we've actually done something about the issue when we have all only talked about the matter. And so from this talk, hopefully we can take something practical and we can implement it into our lives and we can put it into action, because Allah Ta'ala, He says, addressing the believers, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, addressing the believers, O you who believe, Lima taquluna ma la taf'alun, why do you say, why do you talk about that which you do not put into action? Why do you talk about that which you do not act upon? And this is not the characteristic of the believer. This is not a characteristic that is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we ask first and foremost that Allah ta'ala, He protect us from becoming people of kalam, from becoming people of speech. And instead He bless us and He honor us and He make us people of a'mal, people of actions. Thereafter, in regards to connecting the hearts of the youth to the Qur'an, Allah Ta'ala in His wisdom and His ultimate knowledge, He has highlighted and He has preserved this methodology in His Qur'an, so that we, the believers, those who read the Qur'an, we could extract lessons from it, and so that we can implement it into our lives. But we have to stop carrying the Qur'an in our hands and upon our tongues, and we have to start carrying the Qur'an as it was revealed upon our hearts. We have to start carrying the Qur'an upon our hearts. And many of our youth, those who are absent today, many of our youth, they have fallen sick. They have been contaminated and infected with the ills of the heart. Their hearts have been diseased with the desire and the love of this dunya, and it has begun to affect their actions and their character, as well as their appetite. And it all begins with the heart. Our youth, their hearts, they're filled with doubts and uncertainties. And when they go into the schools, what contributes to the problem is that they're getting one thing at home and they're getting another thing in the public schools. For example, here we teach them about Tawheed and the oneness of Allah. But at school they're learning about Greek mythology, Zeus and Hercules, and they have yet to figure out how to put it all together. When they learn about history, when they learn about Mesopotamia, when they learn about this region in the world, they're not learning about the prophets and their offsprings who populated that region. They're not learning about Ibrahim alayhi salam. And so they haven't figured out, how can I put this together? And Allah, He tells us, He created us all from a single soul. But in the schools, the public schools, they're learning about science, and evolution. And this has contributed to the doubts that have affected our youth. However, Allah Ta'ala has provided a cure for this disease, the disease of doubt and uncertainty, the disease of disbelief, the disease of the desire for the worldly things. And he says in his Qur'an, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَرًا. He says, and what we have sent down from this Quran, it is a cure, and it is a healing, it is a mercy for those who have iman, for those who believe. However, for the transgressors, it only increases them in their destruction. It only increases them in their loss. And Allah Ta'ala, He tells us that He provides a solution, and He talks in great detail about the very topic that I was given today, in a very practical way, and with the highest level of eloquence, and with the deepest and the most intimate understanding of the nature and the condition of the human being. And He tells us of this methodology, and on top of that, He tells us of its benefits by drawing our attention to one of His beloved prophets, who Allah Ta'ala Himself, He cultivated at a very young age to show us and to teach us how we should also cultivate and raise up our young, our youth. The Prophet, alayhi salam, who I am speaking about, is none other than Yahya bin Zakariya, alayhi salam. The one whom Allah Ta'ala, He gave him a name that He had given to none before him, as if to say, pay attention to Yahya. There's going to be something special about this child. And in Surah Maryam, in four very short verses, yet these verses are filled to the brim with benefit for those who reflect. Allah says, first and foremost, Ya Yahya, خُذِ الْكِتَابَ بِقُوَّةٍ. He says, O Yahya, take hold of the book with strength. Take hold of the book with strength. Allah Ta'ala cultivating one of the youth of the Anbiya, one of the youth of the Prophets. And I want us to keep in mind, as I go through these short verses, that Allah Ta'ala has arranged them in a very specific and strategic order. And so the verse continues. After Allah says, take hold of the book with strength, وَآتَيْنَاهُ الْحُكْمَ صَبِيًّا. And then He says, we endowed him with wisdom, with judgment, with discretion, while at a very young age. Already the transformation, it has begun. Already the benefits of being connected to the Qur'an, in the very same verse, Allah has connected it. They have already begun. And He mentions first the intellectual transformation. And then the verse, it continues. وَحَنَانًا مِنْ لَدُنَّا وَزَكَاتًا وَكَانَ تَقِيًّا. And we endowed him with tenderness and with purity exceedingly pious. He was exceedingly pious. And I want you to notice these characteristics that I have mentioned: tenderness and purity and piety. The highest qualities for the human being. These are the very same characteristics that the shaitan, the Iblis, he has made to look ugly in our society. He has made these characteristics look ugly in the schools wherein our youth attend. That these are the reason that young people, they are being bullied today, because of their innocence and their purity and their gentleness and their desire. This is their fitrah, their natural desire to embody goodness. These are the characteristics that shaitan, he makes look backwards. And the opposite characteristics, the characteristics of arrogance, kibbutz, the characteristics of selfishness, right? You're not cool if you're not tough. Our youth, they want to be tough and they want to be hard. These are the characteristics that shaitan, he has made beautified in the eyes of the people of today. However, it is the very opposite of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala endowed Yahya alayhi salam with. And we notice that the very first thing that we mentioned was the intellectual transformation, the wisdom and the judgment. And then after that, we mentioned the transformation of the character, the spiritual disposition, the emotional disposition. Because you can't truly change the way you behave until you change the way you think. And the perfection of character, it cannot be attained except with higher levels of understanding. And so Allah Ta'ala, he says in the Qur'an, إِنَّمَا يَتَذَكَّرُ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. He says only those endowed with understanding can truly take heed. And the next verse regarding the transformation that all of us should go, when we connect our hearts to the Qur'an, Allah Ta'ala, he says, وَبَرًّا بِوَالِدَيْهِ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ جَبَّارًا عَصِيًّا. And he says about Yahya alayhi salam, he was righteous to his parents. He was righteous to his parents. And never was he arrogant or rebellious. Maybe our young people today, they do not respect us. Maybe they don't treat us with the respect that we feel that we deserve, because we never took out the time to connect them to the Quran. Because we never took out the time to make sure that they learn how to read the Quran, how they learn how to read the Arabic, so that they could recite it and they could absorb its beauty. But if we do not give our young people their rights, then how can we expect our rights in return? If we do not give our young people their rights, then how can we expect our rights in return? Our youth, they grow up 15, 16 years, 17 years, and we never sat down with them and read the Quran from cover to cover, or half, or a third, or what is less than that. We never sat down and asked our young people, what does this verse mean to you of the Quran? And now we are paying the price. We have to connect their hearts to the book of Allah Ta'ala, as as he has commanded for Yahya alayhi salam, take hold of the book with strength. And we have to realize that the Qur'an, it was sent to transform the entire human experience. Not just our youth, not just us as individuals, but the society altogether. A man entered into a cave at the age of 40, and when he entered into that cave, he was an ordinary man. But when he left that cave, he was no longer an ordinary man. Rather, he was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the messenger of Allah. But what was it that made this transformation overnight? It was the revelation of the Quran. It took him, one who was born as an orphan, not born as an orphan, but became an orphan as a young child, who was born without a father, who could neither read nor write, and he was also from a people who was unlettered, and it took him and it made him into the greatest human being ever to walk the face of the earth. The revelation of the Quran is what transformed him. The revelation of the Quran is what transformed the people around him and that society that was not written in the books of history. It transformed that society. It took people who were slaves. It took people who were criminals, heathens, and it dusted them off, and it transformed them, and it cultivated and developed them until they became the greatest scholars, the greatest generals, the greatest intellectuals ever to walk the face of the earth. This is the purpose of the Quran, and this is the potential for our ummah, if only we embrace the speech of Allah Ta'ala and we made it a companion in our everyday lives. How many of us can say with a sincere heart that the Quran, the speech of Allah, the book of Allah, is our very best friend? How many of us can say that the Quran is the closest companion that we have in the life of this world? That when we wake up in the morning, outside of the month of Ramadan, because the purpose of Ramadan is to increase us in taqwa, and this taqwa should carry us throughout the year, so that we can carry those characteristics and those habits that we developed inside of this month with us all year long. And the Quran, as we read it every day in this month, and we increase in our reading, we should also try to read it every day throughout the year, even if it's only a single ayah. If only one verse or two verses, a page throughout the course of the day, it is huda lil muttaqin, it is a guidance for the people of taqwa. And every single day we need guidance, just as every single day we need food and water. Every single day we need guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That before we wake up in the morning, before we get on the machine, before we check in with the daily news, before we get on the Facebook and the YouTube, the first thing we should do is to check in with the book of Allah Ta'ala. Allah says in the Quran, wa Quran al-Fajr, inna Quran. says, and the recitation at dawn. Indeed, the recitation at dawn, it is something that is witnessed. It is an alibi for those who believe. And perhaps it will be the reason that the Qur'an, the book of Allah Ta'ala, it testifies on your behalf on the Day of Judgment. This is why the Qur'an, it should be your very best friend. يَوْمَ يَفِرُ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ. Because on that day, your brothers, your siblings, your friends, they will abandon you. And your mother and your father and those who you entrusted your life with, they will abandon you. But the Qur'an, if you made it your companion in this life, it will never abandon you. It will testify on your behalf. And Allah, He singles out Wa Qur'an al-Fajr in the Qur'an to tell us to make it a priority, that it should be the first thing on your mind in the morning, the first thing that you seek benefit from. And as well, on the Day of Judgment, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Allah has told us, he will complain. He will complain to Allah when he says, وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ يَا رَبِّ إِنَّ قَوْمِي اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا. And when the Messenger says, oh my Lord, indeed my people, they have taken this Qur'an, they have taken this Qur'an as a thing to be forsaken. They have taken this Qur'an and they have abandoned it. And a woman, she was once asked, and this was a non-Muslim woman, she was asked, if you received a letter from God, if you received a letter from God, what would you do? And she said, I would read it every single day. She said, I would read it every single day. And we as Muslims, we have a risala, we have a letter, we have a message from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the final revelation. But do we read it every single day? And I want to go back, because I mentioned the story of Yahya alayhi salam and the methodology in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has connected him to the Quran, and some of the benefits. And the very fourth verse, the last verse of these short verses, talk about the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal of connecting our hearts to the Quran. That yes, it should benefit us intellectually. And yes, it should refine our character. But the goal is even deeper than that. As Allah Ta'ala, He says, وَسَلَامٌ عَلَيْهِ يَوْمَ وُلِدَ وَيَوْمَ يَمُوتُ وَيَوْمَ يُبْعَثُ حَيًّا. Allah Ta'ala, He says, and peace and security upon him the day that he is born, and the day that he dies, and the day that he is raised up alive, the day that he meets his creator. And these particular transitions in our experience are three of the most challenging transitions that we will ever face, three of the most insecure parts of the human experience. When we are born into this world that is foreign to us, and we have no ability to take care of ourselves, we are in a vulnerable state. Allah has given him peace and security. Even as adults, we still struggle with insecurities. But this was something that was endowed to Yahya alayhi salam even at birth. And then at death, with regret, following us step by step, like a shadow, the decisions that we made in the life of this world, not knowing what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala He is going to do with us. Who can die, who can face death with peace and security, except for one who spent their entire lives preparing for that day where they would meet their Lord, where they would meet the angel of death. And Yahya alayhi salam, as narrated in the book Ibn Kathir, the stories of the prophets, he said that one day, Zakariya alayhi salam, he was looking for Yahya alayhi salam, and he found him. He was looking for him for 3 days, and he found him weeping inside of a grave, which Yahya had dug himself. And he said, "My son, I have been looking for you, and you are dwelling inside of this grave. You are weeping inside of this grave." And he said, "Oh my beloved father, did you not tell me that between paradise and hellfire, there is only a span, and it will only be crossed by the tears of those who weep?" The tears of those who weep. He spent his life preparing for that day. وَيَوْمَ يُبْعَثُ حَيَّا, in the day that he will be raised alive. Who can stand on that day with peace and security except for one who was born for the sake of Allah, and one who lived for the sake of Allah, and one who made that ultimate sacrifice for the sake of Allah? And Yahya alayhi salam, although he possessed those qualities that I mentioned of purity and piety and gentleness, although he possessed these qualities, he was far from a coward. These qualities, they did not make him weak. Rather, they made him strong. And he paid for righteousness, and it cost him his life. It cost him his neck. He died in the cause of Allah. So young people, never think that these qualities make you weak. Never think that these qualities, they make you soft. Rather, they are given to you by the one who is almighty and the one who is all powerful, so that he can strengthen you by them, and so that you can walk in this earth upright and live a righteous life. Be reflections of the Qur'an. And now, I want to conclude by trying to stimulate our appreciation for the Qur'an. Because the real question is, how do we connect their hearts to the Qur'an? How do we connect their hearts to the Qur'an? And number one, we have to tell them, and we have to show them of the proof, and to expel the doubt from their hearts that this book that we recite every day, it can only be from the Creator of the heavens and the earth. It can only be from the Creator of all that exists. And in order to do so, we have to familiarize ourselves with its contents. We have to know why the Qur'an is a miracle, a living, breathing miracle. Because when you recognize these features and these faculties, then only then can you develop the true certainty in your heart. And when you develop the certainty, then comes the taqwa. Because taqwa, it keeps us from disobeying Allah. Taqwa, it makes us conscious of our every decision. But if you do not develop taqwa, then what is going to keep you from disobeying Allah? What is going to keep you on a straight path? We have to develop the taqwa. But first, it comes with developing the certainty. And that comes with explaining to them why the Book of Allah has to be from a divine source. That's only the beginning. That is the foundation, that certainty. And the Quran, in conclusion, and if there are any questions after this point, feel free to ask. There was more I wanted to say, but I don't want to hold you any longer. But I want you to recognize how great the Quran is as we are in the month of Quran. The Quran, number one, it is the best of all revelations. We know this. It is superior. The Quran, number two, it is the best of all miracles. It is greater than the miracles of the prophets of the past, because those miracles, they were only temporary and they only existed in the moment. But the Quran is a living miracle that has survived for over 1400 years. And this, the Quran, number three, it was chosen to be revealed in the best of all languages. And that is what language? What language? The Arabic language. And number four, the Quran, it was designated to be revealed in the best of all places. What place is that? Mecca and Medina. And the Quran, number five, it was chosen to be revealed in the best of all months. What month is that? The month of Ramadan. And the Quran, number six, it was chosen to be revealed in the best of all nights. What night is that? Inna anzalnahu fi laylatul qadr, the night of decree, the night of power. And the Quran, it was delivered by the best and the noblest of all angels. What angel is that? The angel Jibril alayhi salam. And the Quran, it was delivered to the best of all creation. The best of all creation, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Quran, it was revealed upon his heart. It was revealed upon his heart. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said about the heart, he said there's a morsel of flesh inside the body that if it is sound, if it is healthy, then the entire body will be healthy and sound. And that morsel of flesh is none other than the heart. And lastly, number 10, the Quran, it was revealed, it was given to the best of all nations. It was given to the best of all nations. As Allah Ta'ala, He tells us in the Quran, كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. He tells us that you are the best nation ever to be brought forth للناس for the benefit of mankind on three conditions: that you enjoin the good, that you forbid the evil, and that you believe in Allah. And these three conditions, they are a summary. They are a summary of Islam in its entirety. They are a summary of Al-Quran, the book of Allah Ta'ala. That you enjoin the good, that is the religion. That you forbid the evil, and that you believe in Allah. Everything stems from that. But if we do not uphold the Qur'an, and if we do not uphold the example of the one who was the living, breathing, walking, talking example of the Qur'an, then we do not achieve our potential of being the best nation ever to be brought forth for the benefit of mankind. Our success in the dunya and the akhirah, as we have talked about today, as individuals and as a community, it begins by connecting our hearts to the Qur'an. It begins by connecting our hearts to the Qur'an. But that's only the beginning. There's much more that we have to do in order to save ourselves and our families, our youth and our brothers and sisters from the fire. And inshallah ta'ala, that will be another talk, another discussion. I want to conclude with the verse of Allah that truly captures what I feel I spoke about today, the purpose the Quran was revealed and how it manifests in our lives. Because this dunya, it is filled with darkness, and our youth are being trapped and caught up in darkness, different forms of darkness. And if they do not have the Qur'an in their lives, then they do not have light. And so Allah, He says, Alif Lam Ra, Kitabun Anzalnahu لتخرج الناس من الظلمات إلى النور بإذن ربهم إلى صراط العزيز الحميد. He says in Surah Ibrahim, verse 1, Alif Lam Ra, a book that we have sent down in order to bring forth mankind out from every kind of darkness into the light by the permission of their Lord, the one who is almighty and ever praiseworthy. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik wa nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant wa nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. At this time, if there's any questions, feel free to ask. If not, then I conclude here and I allow you to be on your way. Yes.
Allah says, and when you recite the Qur'an, when you read the Qur'an,
He places between you and those who do not believe in the Akhirah, hijab and mastura, an invisible barrier. Right, so number one, we're talking about what? The connection to the Qur'an and how it can benefit us in the social world. Right? So that relationship to the Qur'an, it strengthens you in an intangible way first. Right? They can't get to your mind and they can't get to your heart because you're connected to the Qur'an, because you're connected to your Creator. Right? However, as we know, the greatest challenges that the youth face are the social challenges. Peer pressure, identity crisis, gender relationships, sexuality, all of these are social issues. Where I'm from, it's gangs and crime and things different, right? But still social challenges. And again, it goes back to having certainty. So for example, my solution that I always suggest is that when someone arrives at the age of 12 and 13, they should immediately be entered into some level of da'wah training. Because the same questions that our young people have are the same questions that a non-Muslim would have. The same doubts that our young people have are the same doubts that a non-Muslim would have. So we have to take them from the very beginning. We have to explain to them the oneness of Allah. And we have to give them the proofs for that. Right? So when you develop certainty, now when somebody challenges them for being a Muslim, they can say, look, I know what I believe, but what about you? I know what I believe, but what about you? And most of the time, the person who's challenging these young people out of ignorance, they don't even know what they believe themselves. And so they already have the advantage by knowing what they believe and why they believe it. That answers your question? Any other questions?
I know that everyone faces difficulties in life.
Yes.
But the thing is, how do you overcome these difficulties and focus on the path of Islam? Like, I know there are certain people, whether it be your parents or your friends, who are causing your self-esteem to go down and make you and interfere with your path towards Islam, and it kind of causes you to forget about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It makes your self-esteem go down once again, and it makes you feel bad about yourself. How do you like overcome these difficulties, ignore whatever people are saying, and just focus on doing anything for the sake of Allah?
How do you overcome the challenges, the hardships, the things that people are saying, and focus on the straight path, focus on Allah? Allah Ta'ala, He says, لَقَدْ خَلَقَنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي كَبَرٍ. We have created mankind into toil and hardship. We have created mankind into what? Challenging circumstances. Right? So I think the first mistake is trying to separate the straight path from the challenges that we face. The challenges that we face are on the straight path. That is the straight path, that we do face challenges. Right? I think we have to change our perspective. Right? And we have to recognize that when we face those challenges, that is me staying on the straight path. Right? Not to ignore them and to run away from them, because they're going to continue to follow you until you overcome that challenge. And I'll give you the example, briefly. The example of Musa alayhi salam. We learned a very beautiful lesson from the story of Musa alayhi salam. It is one of the masterpieces of the Quran. Right? Musa alayhi salam, he was born. And soon after he was born, he was cast into the river. Who was he escaping? Who was he escaping? Speak up. Young man. Fir'aun. And his army, right? And Allah saved him. Right? As a young man, Musa alayhi salam, he killed an individual unintentionally. And he ended up in a situation where he would again have to escape who? Who? Fir'aun. You can talk in the month of Ramadan. Talking is not one of the things that we have to abstain from. Right? Now, again, he's escaping Fir'aun. Now, he flees. And Allah, eventually, years later, he sends him back. And he commands him to get his people. And he ended up in a situation again where he would what? He would have to escape Fir'aun. It's the same story over and over and over again, the same situation. Allah, sometimes he puts a challenge in front of us over and over and over again until we pass it. So if you really want to avoid those challenges, you don't go away from them. Rather, you have to face them. Right? And when you face them, this is when Allah, he will make open a way for you. This is when Allah parts open the sea. Right? When you face your fears, when you face your challenges. That is a straight path. Any other questions? Taba'an. I appreciate your company today. I hope what I said has been of benefit and has been pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before anything. I make dua for all of us that we take what we hear and we become people of action, as we said in the beginning. Ameen, say ameen. Right? And that we become true reflections of the book of Allah ta'ala, and we become companions of the Qur'an. And we become from the people of taqwa, and we become young people, the young people sitting here today, that you become ambassadors of Islam. Right? Because what happens is that if you lose a single generation of youth, if you lose one generation of youth, then you have to start from scratch. You have to start all the way over again. You don't realize how much value you have, how important you are to the preservation of Islam throughout time. If we lose one generation, we have to start from scratch. This is how nations got replaced, and this is why prophets were sent. Because one generation lost their way. One generation began to transgress. Right? So may Allah make us a community who is concerned about our youth. And may He make us people who preserve the Quran in our hearts and on our tongues and in our actions. Ameen. Wa subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika wa nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta wa nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Jazakumullahu khairan.